Now, hinge cutting is a viable tool in the toolbox of habitat managers anywhere. And I would challenge, I didn't say this, and I'm gonna talk about when to hinge cut, why not to hinge cut. There are several different, really, signs that you should notice on your property, recognize whether timber species or time of the year to cut. But really, you know, the opportunity to hinge cut on any land is there about 20-25% of the time. If anyone says that hinge cutting is not a viable tool in the toolbox of habitat management, then frankly, they don't have the experience enough to actually make that comment. Because if they did have the experience, they'd recognize that it is a wonderful tool that you can utilize on your land to help whitetails and other wildlife species like rabbits, for example, and grouse. Regeneration, it's something you maintain for years to come. And that's what I like about hinge cutting too, is that I've seen a 20-year-old hinge cut, a 25-year-old hinge cut, and the viability of that and how it continues to grow and how you can still manage that. So it's not a waste of timber. It can be a great utilization of the resources. And if it's a fit for your land, it can be, you know, a great addition to your habitat and your habitat management on the property. When to hinge cut? There are certainly some times not to hinge cut. Number one, when the sap is flowing. Consider right now, we're in a deep freeze in the Midwest, and if you're going out to make a hinge cut, and you're going to create that, and it's a right fit for your land, when that sap is not flowing, it's crystallizing the inside of that tree, it'll shatter. So your hinge cuts that would have been successful in March or April, even December or January when it's a little bit warmer, would not be viable now. They're not going to be effective. They're going to break. It's a waste of the resources. It'll crack. And it's a lot easier to hinge cut when a little bit of sap is flowing. And I would say, like, for example, sap flowing in May or March and April, you get those days when they're making syrup is you know, a really good time. Those big buds are really starting to explode up in the canopy. And those nights might be in the 20s, 30s, but during the daytime it's 40 and 50. So a really good time to actually cut at that time, as opposed to when we're in this deep freeze right now. Everyone wants to go out and cut right now, get habitat management done and bedding area work, but boy, not a great time to do so when it's this cold. On the flip side, if you have canopy reduction, where you're cutting down big mature timber that is over the size of hinge cutting material, you're looking to reduce canopy, allow sunlight into the woods, put big mature trees on the ground every 40, 50 yards, for example. You're just cutting one big tree down. Complete face cut. So it's a complete cut. You're cutting off from the stump. You're not hinging it. You don't want to hinge it. Great time to do so. So, and a lot of times I see on properties, very rarely is it a property where you can only hinge cut on it, for example. Hinge cutting is usually a complement to good practices that are already taking place on the land. For example, canopy reduction. Timber harvest, and we'll talk about some of these, but really watching what's going on right now with the temperature and making sure you're not cutting those trees when it's too cold. Number two, pole timber size. And so I see these properties that have been, they were cut maybe 20 years ago, 15 years ago, 10 years ago, and all this timber is the same size. And when that timber is 6 to 8 inches, it's very difficult, but a lot of times hinge cutting is the best option, especially with hardwood species. You're cutting that timber and you're making hinge cut pockets. You're doing that throughout your woods. It might be that you have an interior area that's 20 acres out of 40. The recommendation in your case might be to make a hinge cut pocket in the inside of that 20 acres every 40 to 50 yards, and that hinge cut pocket would be an eighth of an acre, tenth of an acre. And what you're doing is you're trying to create pockets so you can't see through the woods. You're offering regeneration for deer, side cover. Almost always, unless you're using it for a screening on a ridge system or a road, you're creating hinge cuts that are about waist high. That's what I recommend all the time. Not this head high garbage, it'll hurt you or waste the resources. And the reason for that is you want that cover beginning to regenerate down here at hip high, where deer can actually eat on the hardwood regeneration that's taking place and utilize that cover at deer level instead of above deer level. So pole timber size. And when I say you can reach 100% of your potential, what I mean by that is that might be your only tool in the toolbox for habitat management. You're not gonna harvest. You can't get a forestry mulcher in there because the timber's too large and there's too much of it. And so, and it might not be appropriate. You're gonna put too many chips on the ground and not allow for regeneration. So your option might be to hinge cut those pockets And really what you're trying to do, again, is put that timber on the ground about waist high, and you're hinge cutting so they can continue to grow off the horizontal log, and you're putting that regeneration at face level and then that additional cover too. So you could reach 100% of your potential, meaning this is what you can do with the timber, this is the best way to do it, and you're going to have a 100% fit. Now when I say post-logging, last 20% of the potential, what I mean by that is that with post-logging, you've taken that canopy down, you've reduced the timber, you've select cut, whatever it might be. But in the end, you're completing 80% of your work with the loggers. And so a lot of times I go to a client, we're not just looking at this is what you should do to your land and this is how you should do it and this is what I'm telling you to do. It's I'm working with them based on their resources of time and money, experience level, to create a plan that works the best for them. And it might be that they have other things to focus on, meaning that post-logging, let's say that logging completes 70 to 80% of what you're trying to accomplish in that 20 acres out of 40, or 40% of your land. It might be a select cut. But what you're doing is you're opening up the canopy, you're putting sunlight on the ground, you're creating regeneration, stem count in the form of cover and browse, and that's completing 80% of your potential, 70% of your potential, and someone else is doing all the work. You take that remaining 20, 30% of the potential, you put that into maybe your access trails. You might have travel corridors, deer travel corridors to create. You might have food plots to install, mock scrapes, camera locations, really getting in there and how am I gonna actually kill these bucks, kill these deer, and target them effectively. And I see a lot of people putting time into habitat management, neglecting time of how to hunt, how to access land, how to fit it all together, and they create habitat improvements that actually attract deer to their land only to spook them off because they have a poor hunting plan. So it has to go all together. So a lot of times when I see that last 20% of potential, that would be post-logging. They're leaving trees that are 6 to 8 to 10 inches in under in diameter. And that allows you to go in there in certain areas where you want to enhance the cover and add hinge cuts for that horizontal cover. So it's a step up in cover and it's a step up in browse as deer can browse right along the top of that log that's laying horizontal as opposed to just coming out of the stump. Sometimes appropriate at that time, but really you're only going to gain about 20% of your total potential. Early successional growth upland pockets and setting. So I see these overgrown fields. It's been 30 years since they were logged, and you have these clusters of box elder or red maple, hinge cuttable trees that you can actually hinge to the outside. And what you're doing is you're expanding those areas of cover. You're allowing deer to get in and out. And again, what are you doing? You're offering the potential for browse at head level and cover at side level. So you have side cover. Let me give you an example, wouldn't be exactly the same, but you have a soft maple pocket out in the middle of a 160 acre field. If you hinge cut that timber, just the outside 3 or 4 feet or 2 or 3 rows of trees to the outside, now you expand that area of cover, but deer on the inside of that little pocket, they can't see out, you can't see in, they feel more secure and they have food and regeneration and side cover all around them. Great practice, and if you can imagine that in an upland setting where you have these little pockets of trees growing up and shrubs, cutting those and increasing the amount of cover and browse within that upland area. So another great time to hinge cut. Now the right tree species, various oak, hickory, ash, maple, box elder, all great species to cut, some better than others. For example, deer will prefer the browse of red maple versus hickory. They prefer the browse of ash, but not as much as white oak, for example. White oak hinges is typically better than red oak. So it really depends on your focus. And again, you know, I talk about sap is flowing up there. You're cutting during those warm spells in the winter. And then also a great time to cut in any of those species I just mentioned, a great time to cut is late summer. It could be they're cutting in August, September, but it's after that tree has gone through its growth phase and that energy is going back down to the root system. And so those trees are in a state of almost summer dormancy where it's a great time to cut. There's still plenty of sap flowing. That tree is tender. You can cut it and make a viable hinge cut. So again, the right tree species. And I would say, we'll go over this in a second, in the wrong tree species and when not to cut. But various oak, maple, hickory, box elder, ash, all really good tree species as an example, and there's more out there too that you can hinge cut and have a lot of success. Number six, and I should have led with this, is only if you're going to get sunlight to the cutting. I've seen far too many wasted cuttings. People that paid thousands of dollars to have various habitat managers come out and cut their timber, but then on the south side, there is complete canopy and shade, and that doesn't allow your cuttings to actually grow and flourish and last for decades. They die out because they were 30 feet tall. They're trying to get to the sun. They're getting little bits of sun. They're even leaning towards the sun. You cut them down, now they're in complete shade, and they just simply die, and 3 or 4 years later, they're just a bunch of dead logs and debris laying there like an old blind, deer blind, and they're not being effective. They're not adding any kind of cover or food. I think that sometimes scares people. People see that. They'll see people cutting the wrong tree species. They'll see people cutting hinge cuts and installing hinge cuts in areas where they don't get any sunlight. And they'll look at it and say, boy, hinge cutting's bad. You should never do that. But again, they haven't seen it used correctly. And when they do, it can be a wonderful addition to your habitat improvements on the land. So those are a few things that I really look for when I'm going to hinge cut. When not to, of course, when there's no sun, when it's too cold, very frigid, no hinge cut tool. Now, I'm not even sponsored by the hinge cut tool, the habitat hook created by Nick Nation in Lower Michigan, but he's got a great tool I love talking about. We've been using it for many years with our cuttings that we've had, and it's a great tool. And what a hinge cut tool is good for, and I've seen people try to make them, and I have to admit I've used a 2x4 with a couple big spikes through it in a pinch to push trees over. But what you're doing is you're leaning on that tree, someone's leaning and pushing it, someone's cutting it, you're putting that back cut on it to hinge, and hinge should be completed perpendicular to the tree growth. Tree's growing straight up, you're hinging flat. You don't want to hinge it to the side, one side or the other. That is a dangerous way to hinge. It actually, you can't direct the hinge cut as well. You want it perpendicular to the growth. Tree's coming up, you're cutting it off just like this. What the hinge cut tool allows you to do is on a 6-inch diameter red maple, you only have to cut 2 inches through that tree and into that tree, and someone else is leaning on that tool and pushing that tree over, and it actually hinges, and still you're still leaving 60% of the tree or 40% of the tree, 70% of the tree intact and connected, as opposed to the winter time when it's too cold to cut and you're not using a hinge cutting tool. And even if you're trying to lean on it and push it, you might get 7/8 of the way through, it hinges and cracks and falls off. And so that's what you don't want to happen. Hinge cut tool allows you always to cut through a lesser distance into the diameter of the tree, and that helps the tree be intact and live for decades. Pretty cool. And at the same time, if you get trees hung up, especially those smaller trees, it might be 3-4 inches in diameter, you can use that hook to actually pull it down. But believe it or not, you're actually pushing a lot more than you're pulling with that hinge cut tool. Conifers and aspen. It's just in a property down in Indiana where someone paid $10,000 for 4 days, and primarily what they cut on two properties was red cedar. Now the idea was to try to direct deer with that red cedar, and they made little pockets and openings for deer to move through those. But the problem is the entire south facing area was canopied over. They cut these under hardwoods, and so the deer did not use the cuttings for about 4 years. They avoided the entire area, and it was a lot of area. You can imagine in 4 days of cutting. The hinge cuts were also up high, so it's very intimidating, I'm sure, to deer. And in that case, the red cedar should have been used for cover. The canopy trees should have been cut down, and that would allow sunlight into those scattered red cedar areas, and there would have been an explosion of growth. The deer would have enjoyed, even if the timber was harvested in that area, the person wouldn't have had to do anything else. Just let a logger harvest the big canopy trees and not pay someone to come in and cut just the red cedar out. And so I've seen that in several places with conifers being cut. You don't want to hinge cut conifers, and it's rarely a good idea to leave a mess of conifers into a pocket area or an area you want to bed, because the deer just don't like using them. Where I've seen conifers cut, and it's been a very good idea, is let's say you have a south-facing edge of conifers. The south-facing edge is full of white pines, spruce, maybe even some red pines. There's branches nearly all to the ground because that side of the conifer stand has been facing the south, and so those branches are allowed to live all the way down to forest level. So look at that, and if you take that outside layer of conifers and you cut them completely, you allow sunlight to come into that end of the conifer field on the south end, and it'll thicken back 20 to 30, 40 yards depending on the height of the conifers, and you can create a really nice soft edge full of regeneration and cover. And if you're just dropping those trees to the outside, you extend the cover, you allow brush to grow up within those trees, deer can get in and out because they're running perpendicular to that line of conifers. And so that's one reason to cut conifers and how to do it to where it can be an actual habitat improvement without harvesting the entire stand of conifers. So poplar, aspen. Now, there are ways that you can use really large aspen on a screening side of a woods where you want to thicken that edge. And there are ways that you can actually hinge cut, you can use a plunge cut to actually create a really nice edge where deer can't see through, you can't see them. But at the same time, when you're leaving those trees intact, you're destroying the amount of lateral root regeneration that you typically get from aspen. And that's why you cut aspen or poplar, and that's why you completely cut it and harvest it, because you can expect up to 7,000 shoots per acre. So instead of getting those trees out of a stump or the side of a log, great way to complete a huge explosion of cover and food for lots of different wildlife species. For example, rabbits and then grouse. Grouse love living a certain age of aspen and poplar cuttings. Complete cut. So there are ways to create an edge, and people online will say this is how you hinge cut aspen, and you can effectively do that, but it's not effective for your wildlife habitat. You want to cut aspen and poplar completely. The rare exception might be a field or a wood edge like I was talking about, but even that takes a little bit higher skill level to complete and complete safely. So really looking at conifers, aspen, and poplar, staying away from those, making sure that all your cuts get some type of sunlight into them. And let's face it, hinge cutting is a completely viable tool. And I'll throw in something that doesn't have as much to do with hinge cutting, but with what we're talking about, there's some talk out there. You take a mature maple, mature cherry, the deer like the browse, and you cut that tree down by your stand location. In theory, it's like a mineral lick. People even talked about that. Was, you know, the ground coming out into this young growth, and it's going to explode the potential for deer to come in and feed on those in front of your tree stand. Folks, if you're just cutting one or two or three or four trees, what ends up happening is the deer easily eat that regeneration down to the stump. When they eat that regeneration more than 50% 2 years in a row, it kills the tree. It kills regeneration. I've seen a 40-acre stand of hard maple that was completely cut next to a deer yard in a rock area of upper Michigan. And there's nothing growing 5 years later in that entire area, because all the regeneration was killed by the deer that were in the deer yard next door. So think about that when you're cutting timber, when you're trying to attract deer to a tree stand. It sounds pretty cool. We don't need food plots. We don't need mineral licks. We don't need anything. We're just gonna cut a major, giant hardwood down by your stand location. We'll create this bush, an explosion of growth that the deer can feed on forever. And folks, that's not the case. Usually it's eaten down to the stump. You need to cut acres of hardwoods, not one or two or three, and call it a bait pile in front of your tree stand. Hinge cutting, again, great viable tool. For most of you out there on most of your parcels, it probably is not a fit, but when it is, again, it is an outstanding addition to your whitetail habitat. Consider hinge cuts this year, especially in the off season. You have some great time coming up before the end of the winter to cut. If you have those large mature canopy trees that you need for sunlight and to reduce canopy, that's a great time to cut right now, even if it's really cold. And then just waiting till the sap is flowing, or waiting till mid to late summer to get those hinge cuts on your land. And you can have some great habitat and great useful habitat that you can actually manage for decades to come. And I encourage you to try a hinge cut, use a hinge cut tool, use your helmet, use your chaps, use your face shield, and cut safely and have a great off season. Now, as we transition into habitat season, I hope you've had a chance to check out my web class, How to Design your Whitetail Parcel. It's on my website, whitetailhabitatsolutions.com. I have a link in the description, and I hope you can find it, check it out, and enjoy it this year.